Hello, good evening, good day to all my fellow travelers. Chris Lee here. Welcome to my travel channels. Just a preview of today's travelogues. I will cover my travel journey involving a river cruise along the Tonle Sap Lakes, which cover countryside of Cambodia. Now, as the journey, right, is took place in the year 2007. Therefore, thus all the images that I'm sharing with you today were of 14 years old. Now, I believe all these images no longer reflect the current situation in Cambodia, but it does give us a better understanding of Cambodia's past, a valuable piece of documentary travelogues. So to begin with, let's look at the maps of Cambodia. Now please note the whereabout of these two cities. Alright, the point one is basically is a Phnom Penh and Samrat at point two. Now look at another maps of Cambodia. Now this is the map I'm sharing with you of my travel routes from Phnom Penh to Samrat, right? A tourist town located at the north of the Tonle Sap Lakes. Now this route map shown the path I took. Now the journey involved both the river cruise and public bus. I took the river cruise to Samrat, and in return journey I took the public bus back to Phnom Penh, right? Now the durations of river cruise was about 4 hours plus, and the journey on public bus took much longer, about 7 hours, which include a midway stopover for breaks or for lunch or toilet call. Now here are some of the guidelines for those who wanted to follow my backpack footstep to visit the Cambodia and are planning to take the river cruise and the public bus. As I mentioned earlier, that I have taken one of the alternative, that is the river cruise. And I'm also, right, mentioned that the duration taken is about 4 hours plus, but you need to be at the departure hall of the jetty, usually 30 minutes before departures. Now, this form of transport is only available during wet or monsoon season. Now, the reason being, when the so-called river water level in the Tonle Sap Lake and the river is low, especially during the dry season, the bottom of the boat will touch the riverbeds. So you may ask, when is the monsoon season? It's from July to November each year. Therefore, the operating of this river cruise is not the whole year round, but only during the monsoon season and subject to the water level in the Tonle Sap River. Now, the boat fare is between USD the $25 to $38. So in the region about 100 ringgit to 150 ringgit per person. Now on the return journey, I took another alternative. Is the public bus. The duration, as said earlier, about 7 hours, inclusive of a short break midway. And the bus fare is about USD 15 or about 60 ringgit, right, in Malaysia, ringgit. Now, could be more if a smaller vehicle is used and of a better grade, right, then the bus fare will be higher. Now, some of transport company provide hotel pickup service. And you need to check on this. It doesn't mean they apply to all the hotel. If they do provide hotel pickup service, the cost could have been included in the fare. So be prepared to pay slightly higher fare. Now, but anyway, it's worth for the convenience and less worry, right? In fact, I took this option so that I need to worry too much on the following day after I woke up, you know, from the bed, all the other planning and worry just need to get myself ready, right? And just at the scheduled time, waiting at the lobby, waiting for pickup. That's all. I did not need to worry of missing bus or going to the wrong station either. Now, of course, now for this, for those who want to cut down their travel times and who can afford more expensive mode of travels, then they can actually can take a flight because there is an airport in Siem Reap. And the duration of the flight is about only 45 minutes, and but you need to go to the airport earlier and with all the security checking. So the actual time taken could be around 2 hours, right? So after looking at this road maps, let's move on to the next image. I'm showing you another map again. Please look at these maps of Cambodia and pay attention to the whereabout of the Tonle Sap lakes and river. Because I'm sharing with you, right, a river cruise which will only available during monsoon season or periods. It's important to have some prior knowledge of the geographical condition of Cambodia during the monsoon period. Now, there are actually basically two main rivers in Cambodia, right? Of course, including many smaller and shorter rivers between the land of Cambodia. They all play a vital role and give great influences to all the inhabitants and their to not only to have it, also to their living lifestyle in Cambodia. Tonle Sap River and Mekong River, which the two main rivers, when they meet at the location where Phnom Penh City is located, as shown in the map, then they merge to form another river of the name Basak River. And this river will then flow southward, continue its journey into Vietnam. Okay, let's find out how monsoon water, all right, or monsoon rains waters affect the land of Cambodia, particularly around the Tonle Sap Lakes and river regions. Now, seasonal flooding around Tonle Sap Lakes and river is a norm to the inhabitants. People of Cambodia have already getting used to this months-long seasonal flooding and have taken steps, right, to reduce the impact and damages caused by the flood. So let's get some facts right. These Tonle Sap lakes and rivers is not only a river but also a lake. The lake was formed, right, by the swollens at the middle part of the river and is a complicated and combined lake or reservoir and river system in Cambodia. And I will explain why. Now, during dry season, now the surface water of the Tonle Sap lakes and river is about 2,600 square kilometers during, but then during the monsoon season, the water surface area expanded 4 times over an area of about 10,400 square kilometers. And this is what happened when flooding occurred during the monsoon season. And it affects the region and that sit next to the Tonle Sap Lakes and River in Cambodia. So let's look at this map, right, which highlighting the flooded the regions occur annually in Cambodia, the color in blues. So during the dry season, so can you see the black line demarked the boundary of Tonle Sap Lakes, as well as the Tonle Sap River, which is just the darkened black line on the map. But when the Tonle Sap Lake and River is flooded, the blue color region or area on the maps will expand and go beyond these black lines or boundary of the lake and river, all right? So during the dry season, This is clearly illustrated in this map now, right in front of you. So, how this massive flooding occur at Tonle Sap Lakes and River? Now, the swellings of the size of the lake and the river is mainly attributed by the swelling of the Mekong River caused by the monsoon rain. What Mekong River got to do with Tonle Sap River and lakes? Let me explain further. Now, when Tonle Sap River is connecting, and discharging into Mekong River, which is a much bigger river with a larger volume of water and also higher velocity or speed of flow, definitely the flow rate of Tonle Sap River will be disrupted and hence slowed down in discharging into the Mekong River, the monsoon water, I mean. Now this is what happened to Tonle Sap River, right? So when the monsoon water of Tonle Sap River could not speedily discharge into Mekong River, its water level would then build up, right, gradually at the bottleneck area, right? That's actually at the connect point to the Mekong River. High water level at the downstream will then cause backflowing of the monsoon water from the downstream of Tonle Sap River back to the Tonle Sap Lake, a kind of reverse flow. So around the Tonle Sap regions, mainly are of low-lying area. So backflowing water quickly fill up this low-lying area soon after the monsoon season started each year and cause the low-lying area to be waterlogged and merged with the Tonle Sap Lake and River. And thus, this caused the lake area to expand 4 times from its original size. So now you understand why, right? Now, so this massive months-long seasonal flooding take place in Cambodia. It's become it's a yearly affair, and as far as concerned, the people are just getting used to it every year that will come during the monsoon season. Good thing is, now the people here have gotten used to all this flooding, and they have a way to tackle them and have lived amicably with it for a few hundred years now. Now, Tonle Sap Lakes and River is being regarded as the Southeast Asia's largest freshwater lakes and own the name of Nile of the East. It's important to note that most of the populous region in Cambodia are mainly linked closely to both Tonle Sap and Mekong River. Now, it is the lake and the river that bring life to these regions. And you can see how important this river and lakes to the Cambodian people. As inhabitants live around the Tonle Sap lakes and river are mostly either fishermen or farmers or both. Hence, they need to live and build their home next to the river bank or edges of the lakes that will never dry up even during dry season. In other words, you had to live near a waterway that have water all year round. Simply because river is their lifeline for water, for food, transport, as well as sources of income for the entire family. Right? They all are fully aware of the place they built their home, which will be submerged in flood water during monsoon season. But they have no other choice. So how are they going to tackle this seasonal change in water levels? I will share and explain to you as I share my cruise images later on in my travelogues. So on the other hand, right, the backflowing of monsoon water back to the upstream of Tonle Sap River and lakes has its benefit too. Now, this will prevent the serious flooding occur at the downstream region, which are populated in a way good for the inhabitants, right, at the downstream region and also to the nation as a whole. Thus, the lake acts a natural retention lake very well. So let's share about why I decided to have this 2-day, 1-night travels. to Cambodia. When I planned to visit Angkor Wat at Siem Reap, it was just an impromptu decision, right? Simply because I'm bored, you know. After a few days of lazing off my time in the Strait of Phnom Penh, for those who already visited my episode number one, we already shared with you the yesteryear of Phnom Penh. So my accompanying friends, they were all very busy with their works, right? The trip to Cambodia, right? It was me joining their business trip, you know, and I have no, or without any form of business attachment, more so as a leisure tour for me. Now, so this was how I molded the idea of exploring Cambodia outside the city of Phnom Penh and decided to begin my solo 2-day, 1-night backpack to Siem Reap. With the help of the hotel reservation or reception, I have to say, I have all the booking done, including the ticket for the boat rides, the river cruise, in this case, the hotel stay in Siem Reap. I pre-booked them because I want to avoid any form of disappointment. So from here is the start of my river cruise journey. Please stay tuned. Now in this image, it's shown the earlier hours of the days on the day of my cruise, right? It was about 6 a.m. in the morning after I got myself dressed and ready for the journey. My pre-booked tuk-tuk was arrived on time to pick me up, right, to the jetty, which is not far from the place I stayed. At that hours of the day when I left the hotel, the street, right, all the way from the hotel till the jetty, were almost deserted with very, very few pedestrians on the street and only my tuk-tuk. Now, when I arrived at the jetty, so this is how it looked like. It was a bit early and I waited in the jetty departure hall for some time. Now, the moment I saw the rising sun, you know, I rushed out and walked over to the floating docks, the place where passengers embarking and disembarking from the boats to capture some of the sunrise scenes around the jetty. Now in this image and the next image show the external view of the jetty terminal building and the floating docks. Now this was the boat I took to ferry me to Siem Reap. So when it was about time to board the boats, right, and passengers start leaving, right, the departure hall and move orderly toward the docking platform and waiting for an order to onboard the boats. After I board the boats, I realized I was the only Malaysian in that boat or in the boat trips. And with few Vietnamese travelers, and the rest of the passengers on board were from Western country. After the trip, I only realized that this cruising boat that I took was catering for the need of tourists and was a tourist boat. The local will not take this type of ride, you know, either because the boat fare is too costly for them or it's not justifiable for incurring such expenses. No, I was just want to say, you know, when on board these boats, although the boat was equipped with the air-conditioned cabin and a comfortable seat, I didn't even spend even a minute in the cabin. Instead, I spent all my hours of the boat journey, right, standing outside the cabin with one hand gripped firmly to the handrails beside me, right, to prevent me from falling into the river, and with the other hand holding my 1.5 kilograms cameras. Under the hot sun, without a shade over my head, with full concentration on capturing of the countryside sceneries presented in front of me, which I'm going to share with you later. Right? So please stay tuned till the end of this episode for my hard work, I think. Yeah? And I thank you very much in advance for doing so. So this will be a sunrise scene before the cruise begin, right? And there are two more images on this. Now, then we'll move on to the scene, right? This on the both side of the riverbank of the Tonle Sap River at the very early section of my cruise. Now, along the riverbank, the dwelling were all closely packed together. Okay, let's examine the dwellings in this image carefully. Do you notice some dwellings or building, if you like to call it, platform? The building platform were built high above the water level, and some just barely 200 to 400 mm above it. Why are they having such a big difference in level? Now, the manner these dwellings constructed are amongst few methods adopted by the inhabitant, right, in tackling the seasonal flooding. Now, as explained earlier, during monsoon season, the river and the lake boundary will expand outwards into the neighboring land area. And the water level of both lake and river could rise to a height, sometimes even exceeding 3 meters from the existing water level during dry season, under extreme cases, I presume. Now, the method one that they adopted, that is for dwelling that built high above the water surface, they were actually rigidly anchored onto the riverbeds with long wooden poles or concrete poles as support. So the residents here raised their building platform high above ground in anticipating the highest possible water level of the flood during the monsoon season. They mean they may have record over many hundred or thousand a year. They roughly know the worst scenario have arrived. They assume that that is the highest possible flood level can reach. On the method two, the dwelling with their building platform seemed very above the water surface, right? About 200 to 400 mm as seen in this image, right? These dwellings were built on floating building platform. This floatable building platform have no problem with the rising water level during monsoon season, except one important thing they had to take note. The dwellings must securely, right? Anchor to the firm and heavy object or riverbed as to avoid being drifted away by the flood water. So these are the two most commonly used methods of construction of the dwelling in flooded region. Possibly also covers all other frequently flooded area in Cambodia. Both methods are still in use today. So the measured distance from the existing water level to the base of building platform of this dwelling will give you an insight of the likely height of the flood water under the extreme flooding conditions. On the average, under normal conditions, the dwelling will build at least 1 meter above the worst possible flood water level. This is as a safety measure. If you still could not visualize what I have just explained, right, not to worry. The front images will help you to have a better understanding of this matter later. So let's look at more images of dwellings around the Tonle Sap River, which is the main purpose of today. Now, so you can see that the in this image, it should be the earlier one, right? You can see the few of the building were built on floating platform, and then this can easily identify from the image by judging the distance of the building platform away from the water surface, right? I believe you can spot that. And one of those dwellings that behind this few floatable unit of dwelling, they were built on dry land on the side of the riverbank, right? Which will submerge in flood water during the monsoon season. Thus, these buildings are built high above ground. Usually these buildings are of permanent structure in nature, such as the use of reinforced concrete and brick as their building material, right? This means that the dwelling is here to stay and is expected to last a much longer period of time. Now, the inhabitants around the lakes and rivers regions are mainly fishermen or farmers, I did mention just now, or both, even in modern Cambodia today. Right. As such, the presence of fishing boat on the river is of no surprise to many. There will be more images with fishing boats appear in all my subsequent images beside this image. Right. Now, could you spot many piles of dry grass or paddy stalk? I believe harvest from the rice field nearby, located along the riverbank in this image. Yes, I'm sure. Now, this pile of dry paddy stalks are used to feed domesticated animals, such as buffalo, cow, and goats of the farmer. Now, these piles of dry paddy stalk are common sight along the entire stretch of the riverbank, and this implies this region is a rice-producing district of Cambodia. So in this image and next three images, the pile of dry paddy stalk, right, will rise well above the, you know, with the same level with the building platform, right, so that when flooding occur, this paddy stalk will not be submerged in the flood water and also can be easily accessed by boat. Now, in this image, the material used for the construction of the dwelling, right, were relatively primitive and traditions. They were using dry coconut leaf. In Malaysia, we call it atap. Right? It's laid in layer and in an overlapped manner, as shown in this image. Now, the atap used, besides as a roof covering material, but also as a building enclosure. This implies the dwelling's owner in this region were much, much poorer. Let me explain. Phnom Penh is located at the southern end of Tonle Sap River, and Siem Reap is located right at the northern bank of Tonle Sap Lake. When we travel, or when I travel from Phnom Penh to Siem Reap, I'm actually heading north and move away from the city of Phnom Penh. So I'm basically moving from an urban district to a suburban district, then to a rural regions. So the drop in the living standard of inhabitants I've seen in these images of mine is well expected, you know, a common sight around the world. Now, we will have to take note that this is actually the a very common sight is basically Tampa. Now, when I was cruising along this river, I could spot a lot of Buddhist temples. They were built sit next to the river, right? And this is understandable, right? As the waterways of the river provide convenience and flexibility for the local to commute freely. This explains why many such temples were built just next to the river, and the location was selected to best suit the need of the local, right, in general, and the worshipper in particular. Now, many impressive images of this temple were taken, as shown in this image and the next few images. Now, in this image, I suspect these regions have a bad TV receptions. This could easily identify from the presence of a long antenna post, TV antenna post, right? Now, this is a general sight at area or regions around the world as well that experience poor TV receptions. So, in this image, the TV antenna of this dwelling was protruding high above the dwelling roof. So more country sightseeing of upper section of Tonle Sap River and the lake region, very shooting countryside scenery at this stretch of river cruise. All right. Now, and also there are quite a number of images capture fishermen doing their daily routine works, that is fishing on the Tonle Sap lakes and river in their small size wooden boats. So actually, I'm indeed very much pleased that I have made the right choice by choosing this river cruise, and it's provide me with the opportunity of witnessing with my own eyes the living lifestyle of fishermen and farmer in this region of Cambodia, which could not be done on cruise, can only be done on cruise, sorry, not by air or by land. So the next thing is that when you see this scene in this image, when the river got widened at this stretch of the cruise, will mean that we are actually entering the lake region. Remember, I told you that the Tonle Sap Lake is a swirling of the Tonle Sap River at the middle section of the river. So I'm going to share with you more of breathtaking countryside view along the way. So we are now at the wider spot of the lake region of Tonle Sap Lakes, and the bank was much further away from our boat. And actually, as we are approaching the upper or northern portion of the Tonle Sap Lakes, not far from Sam Raps, right? And this was the last quarters of this river cruise journey. Now we can spot more human activity and settlements. And both on the banks of the river as well on the water. Now from this image and subsequent images that you will notice that the lake was getting very, very busy, you know. And with a lot of activity, such as the traffic of boats, small cargo ship and the like, which very rarely you can find at the lower section of the lake and river, but only in this last quarter of the journey. This is the motor boat I refer to. You can only find just boats ferrying in this part of the lakes. Now over here, all the houses were built high above lake water levels. And this implied the flood water of the lake can reach to a very high level in these regions. Now, since the time of my visit took place was in September 2007 at the midst of the monsoon season. Right, I would believe that the worst of floodings could have arrived, but this is not the case as the flooding condition vary each year. Right, so when entering into the peak of the monsoon season, the lake water level could raise to a much higher level, possibly another a meter or two from the current level, as seen in this image. Then I spotted this boat paddling close to my cruise boats, right? And saw this old lady with her grandchildren looking at us, you know. We wave at them and they smile back. What a friendly return, right? This is a much closer view. And finally, the cruise ended after I disembarked from the boats and was on tuk-tuk heading to my pre-book hotel in Sam Rap Town. On the way, I spotted many such wear down huts as shown in this image. And I was told by my tuk-tuk driver that those who stay here were ultra poor family, and usually with 3 to 5 people crammed into one hut. And I have no better words to describe the living condition of these families. It was just and disheartening scene, and I'm blessed they could have been better now with the blooming of the tourism industry in Sam Rap, of course, for the year 2020 and also the beginning of 2021. We're still under the pandemic of COVID-19. I hope this pandemic will soon over. So this is the end of my river cruise from Phnom Penh to Sam Raps. and thus end my second episode of my travels journey to Cambodia. Now, as this was an unusual travel trip, right, took by me and also by some of the visitor or tourists, and not many of them, tourists, could have the opportunity to view so comprehensively of this countryside scenery of Cambodia like you. Most tourists will prefer taking a direct flight from whatever places in the world to Siem Reap, and they will miss all this. So my entire journey was blessed with good weather. It was indeed a trying day for me, right? After I stood there nearly for 4 solid hours on the cruising boats with camera on my one hand without a minute of let go. But I did not regret nor feel tired, as I was very excited by the beauty of the countryside scenery around the Tonle Sap Lakes. I hope you have been entertained and equally excited and enjoy the entire journey of this cruise presented to you by me in Tonle Sap Lake and River. So please support by subscribing, share, and give me a thumb up. Of course, this is important to me, right? And lastly, in this pandemic, please stay safe, stay strong. See you guys next week in my next episode of my travel to Angkor Wat at Siem Reap, a very popular spot for many. Stay tuned and bye.